meet you.
You too.
I wanted to come introduce myself because we talk all the time, and I didn't know. Right, and I asked Josh. And that's what he said, so good. Well, you ready to go?
Yeah.
All right. If you need anything, just holler at me. Justin, they're sitting right there. Well, I hate to leave Justin.
Make sure they're
performed.
There can't be a postpone.
There's an interesting.
There's an emotion.
you doing?
Here tonight, in the presence of your Son, Jesus Christ. All that we ask for this evening, Lord, is guidance, and we will be very careful to give you all the glory. In God's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight. We have a good crowd. We're on to the adoption of the agenda. Any changes to tonight's agenda, Commissioners?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move that we postpone old business number two to September 5th for the purpose a good gesture holding an additional public hearing to
September 5th as I stated.
I have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
I have a motion. Second. Postpone item two for additional public hearing on September 5th. Council, you're opposed. Is that all right?
That's fine, Mr. Chairman.
Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Any other changes or additions or deletions? County Manager?
I have none, thank you, sir.
County Attorney?
Mr. Chairman, I have one. This will be require a forfeit vote to add. Mr. Chairman, I would ask that this be placed at the end of the new business agenda. The rules of the Board of Elections and registrations require that the Board of Commissioners accept the nominee for representation on that board. We do in fact have a nominee from the local county Democratic Party that will need your attention to fill a new term. So I would ask that we make a motion to add, as the, I guess that would be item three under old business ratification.
You said new or old?
Did I say
you said old?
New. Item number, yes.
Yes,
sir. To ratification of the Democratic Party's representative on the Board of Elections registration. So moved.
Second.
Have a motion, second. And item three of the new business. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Any other changes by the Board? Do I hear a motion to adopt the agenda as amended?
So moved.
Second. Have a motion and second, please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Announcements and reports. We have a proclamation by the Board of Commissioners this week claiming September 2nd through the 6th as Civic Participation Week. And it reads as follows. Whereas the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia desires to proclaim September 2nd through the 6th, 2013 Civic Participation Week. And whereas during this week, American democracy and civic participation will be showcased in honor of the courageous spirit of the American people, and tribute will be paid to those souls lost in the fight for freedom of the American people. And whereas citizens across the county are encouraged to come together to celebrate our county's democratic system during Civic Participation Week. And whereas the celebration shall serve to encourage the county residents to participate in their community in and they're going to be committed to the following four acts of citizenship. Volunteer their time and talent to a cause or a community group they feel passionate about. Make the county a better place by helping others in need. Be role models for their peers and mentors for children. Contribute money or in-kind donations to worthy organizations or causes. Give generously. Teach others and the children the rewards of giving. Communicate their ideals. Be receptive, respectful, responsive, and have responsibility. Look for common ground and craft solutions together. Keep an open dialogue with city, county, state, federal government officials. Know where those officials stand on issues of concern. And vote with knowledge, conviction, and purpose. Be role models. Teach their children about city responsibility and voting as a cornerstone of our democratic system. Now, therefore, it be resolved by the Board of Commissioners that September 2nd through the 6th, 2013, is hereby proclaimed as Civic Participation Week in Forsyth County, Georgia. In honor of the values of American democracy and civic participation in the Board of Commissioners, we urge all citizens of Forsyth County, Georgia to participate in the observance of this Civic Participation Week. In testimony whereof, we shall have hereunto affixed the seal of the County of Forsyth, State of Georgia, and the signatures of the members of the governing body thereof this 15th day of August 2013. Thank you.
Is she here?
Mrs. Good is here.
Yes, okay, nice. Ms. Good, would you come forward? I didn't see you sitting, I'm sorry.
If you have documents for the commissioners, please provide those to the clerk. If fewer than seven copies are submitted, only one copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they signed up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. Mr. Chairman, we have 12 public comment speakers signed up this evening, 11 county residents, one non-county residents. Considering our limit of 10, I would ask the board's direction on how you'd like to proceed.
I'd like to proceed to let the 11 residents speak first and see if we have any time left over. Do we need a motion for that, council?
I think what we can do is just go ahead and set the allotted time, and when the allotted time is up, we'll seek board direction at that time.
Thank you, sir.
Our first speaker is Elisa Townsend.
Thank you very much, commissioners.
My name is Elisa Townsend. I've been a resident of Forsyth County for 10 years. I live in Laurel Springs. I wish I had more information. Everything that's going on with the development on Nichols Road has happened very fast and furious. And my HOA apparently is just now taking hold of this information. So a lot of people in my neighborhood are warning the grassroots effort. They really want to get more involved with the smart growth and controlled growth of our neighborhood. People have moved here because of our schools, because of the quality of life, because of the beautiful landscape around us. Living on Laurel Springs, I'm very concerned about the traffic on Old Atlanta. I'm very concerned about our fire department and emergency vehicles during the morning hours and the afternoon hours. You have gridlock. You already have three schools that are overcrowded within half a mile of one another. You have Sharon Elementary, River Lodge, and Lambert, three of the most heavily populated schools in the area. So what we are proposing is that we reevaluate the development on Nichols Road. You need more information. And it's also my understanding that when the traffic, there was a survey done on traffic on Nichols Road by the developer, maybe by his attorney, and they happened to choose the last week of school. None of the seniors were there. My daughter and all of the honor students that had A's in their classes weren't there. So you were not looking at a true indicator of traffic flow in that area. So we are going to be looking at, we already have problems with parking at that school. We have a lot of kids parking at the rec center. You have children parking at a resident's home by a produce stand. And if you continue to let these developments come in and stack a lot of homes into a small area, and people come here for those schools, so we know that you are going to be looking at probably two students per home. So when you do the math, we're very concerned. I'm concerned about children crossing the roads, concerned about their safety. I'm also concerned about the crowding of the classrooms. And I'm just proposing that we look further into the traffic flow, do another survey when it is more typical of the traffic. So I live there, I see the traffic, and most of the drivers are 16, 17-year-olds, which only adds to the mayhem. So we're looking at a very critical safety issue and overcrowding. And so I'm all for growth. I mean, anyone can move here, but it needs to be controlled. And I'm just proposing more time for us to get the correct people and maybe even some legal attorneys, some people looking into all the issues that are facing us as residents. And that's my concern. Thank you very much.
Gentlemen, one second. Could you stop talking for a second? Council, can I just say one comment about that zoning? It seems that our process here, and I know people out here talk about this, I love the comment, but this zoning has not even gone to our planning zoning board, which they will hear August 27th. A lot more information will come out about that. It hasn't even come to us. We know about it, but we have had a public hearing on, and we will have that on August 27th for your information. So it'll be 6:30 here for the first public hearing of the planning zoning board. Okay. Just want to put that out there.
Our next speaker is Noelle Boz-Salerno.
Thank you, and I hear your comments. I'm not talking about that. However, I'm here to just provoke a little bit of insight and thoughts that a lot of people in our community have had. I as well live in Laurel Springs as Elisa Townsend. And the emergency vehicle issue she brought up is a good issue. As a matter of fact, I was walking this morning and heard the sirens going off, and then I heard them honking, and I heard them honking an abundant amount of times. And that was at 8:05 this morning, which meant to me only that there was a bunch of traffic on Old Atlanta, which didn't allow for the inherent emergency vehicles to get through. So that is a big concern. Also, when Lisa had stated that they had done the study on that road, apparently I also heard that Nichols was also closed due to construction at that point in time. So we can push it back and just reevaluate, like she had stated. I think it's an excellent idea. Also wanted to let you know that the homes in Laurel Springs, as you know, the inventory is certainly very low right now. The homes in there are typically between 400 and a million plus. The homes in the $500,000 to $600,000 range sell like pancakes or hotcakes, however you want to state that, as we all know the saying. So I don't understand why the pullback on the developer wanting to go rent as for this community. I think that with the other homes on James Burgess in the $300,000 range, I think we have an overabundance of $300,000 homes in the area. And I think that there are no homes in the range, $500,000 to $600,000 range, that are new homes that are on the market right now, that I think would be a great asset to the area. It would limit the amount of cars coming in that area, it would limit the traffic, it would limit the students, it would limit everything that everybody's having concern. And obviously, everybody's in business to make money, like the developer and the landowner, and I think they can come to an agreement upon a property price that would include a res for zoning, if that's what we need. It's not to stop the zoning from happening at all, because you just can't do that. But I feel that we need to look at the amount of res for we're giving and the amount of homes that are going up in our area due to all the issues that we have. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Kristin Stevens. Mostly about the comprehensive plan. There's a little reference to the zoning across the street, but more in how it got to be that way. A couple weeks ago, we went to Ethan Underwood's committee participation meeting about the Ballantry home wanting to purchase the property, and he told us that the designation had been changed from Res 3 to suburban detached living. We later found out that that was Res 4. And believe it or not, none of us seem to know when or why that was changed, and maybe we should have, as it has been pointed out to me by some developers and realtors and all those people who were at the meetings. But the bottom line is, I went to figure out how it changed and found out there was publications through all sorts of Forsyth County website, Forsyth County this and that, and as great a news source as they are, because of the way that communications have changed and technology has changed, we don't always use those sources as our primary resources for information. So I'm thinking to myself, is this another one of those county-initiated, you snooze, you lose situations? And I was soon to find out that it was actually worse than that. I found out that Forsyth County was required to file a community participation plan with two state agencies before they even went about doing their comprehensive plan to make sure that there was a very good variety of constituents who were involved in the planning process. And so the county did file that plan with those state agencies, which is great. But I took a look at that document and I was pretty shocked with what I found. In the comprehensive community participation document, it clearly states at the bottom of the first page that the stakeholders were to be identified. And it went on to list 100 stakeholders, and including in that is HOAs, which then would be another hundreds of HOAs. And that we were supposed to be contacted by email, and that we were supposed to be interviewed one-on-one, and that did not happen. I secured 25 of those interviews. There was only 25 out of the 100. Only 13 of those people were on the list of people who were supposed to be interviewed. And there was not a single HOA in the entire county that was interviewed. So I don't have much time left to talk to you about this, but I have provided you guys a printout of the state agency that I spoke to and what they had to say about this. And the fact that Charlie Laughinghouse, when he was in position on the commission, he had made a motion that someone on the HOA representing HOAs be put on the steering committee, and he couldn't get a second to that motion. And then we were shut out of the planning process as it stated in the public participation document. Thank you. Our next speaker is Rebecca Ricks.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm Rebecca Ricks. I'm here speaking for myself and for the participants and the morning walkers at Windermere Park. As you know, I'm sure you remember I was here about several months ago.
Everything that I have requested be done within their part has been done. It's beautiful, we love it, and then we got the floods. We had three floods since it was totally redone. We had our conversations and we decided that we're not going to bug y'all about doing any more repairs until the weather changes and the pattern is totally changed. There's no sense in throwing more money. One of the things I wanted to do tonight, though, was I wanted to thank the people that have worked so hard at Windermere Park. Jerry Kinsey, Jonathan Rowe, Keith Hardiman, Danny Clinton, Tony Holbrook, Mitchell Ricker, Brandon Martin, Levi Faulkner, Ed Castleberry, Anthony Slater. I'd also like to let you know that the Water Department and Roads and Bridges have been champions. They have just, when they found out what the problem was, they jumped right on it and got it done. So, only, oh, and I'd also like to thank Doug Deere for getting this story. Thank you, Doug. One of the things, the only thing we really have a problem with now, two things. I gave out pictures. I think you have the pictures. Okay. Doug did the pictures. The problem we have out there now, and it's nothing to do with the Parks and Rec Department. It's to do with the YMCA. They have told me, you'll see these, and that they have no broken goals out there. We have 22 goals. And out of the 22, there may be two that you could actually set up and play. The rest of them are busted. They promised, the guy from the Y has promised to remove it, and he's not done so. I would really appreciate some help, and I think Parks and Rec would appreciate some help from somebody of getting this correct. And then we have another problem. We have leaks that are coming in on Sunday morning from Gwinnett, Cobb, and DeKalb, and take over the park and play soccer. Nobody has a permit to play. And we cannot get them to get permits. So I'd like to know if we could possibly get our park ranger to come out there one Sunday morning. They're there usually from 8 to 10, playing, and ask them to get permits or don't come out. Thank you. I appreciate your help.
Our next speaker is Joan Rusek.
Hi, I'm Joan Rusek. I represent the Bethlehem Downs HOA. I'm on the board there. We're discussing Amendment AZ-130016, which I heard you say earlier is going to be postponed in a public hearing on September 5th, but I would just like to have a couple of comments. The builder is saying to build townhouses, and for the exit, they would be exiting on a driveway from First Citizens Bank, which is on Bethlehem Road. This comes out onto Bennett Parkway, across from the main driveway of GAF, which is a factory and has tractor-trailer trucks constantly entering and leaving every day. If homes were built on Bennett Parkway and the families have children, there are no sidewalks and they would have to walk in the road to go to the bus stop. School buses do not stop at every home. Also on this property, Atlanta Gas has a 50-foot easement on this property and also a pumping station, and it has a 100-year lease. According to Atlanta Gas, if the property is on the easement, residents would not be allowed to install fences and would have to look at the pumping station. At the last public hearing, Attorney Lipscomb stated that the price range of these homes would start at $240,000 for 1,400 square feet. Mr. Levent, you are a builder, you know no one is going to spend $240,000 for a 1,400 square foot house. Currently, the homes in Bethlehem Downs range from 1,700 square feet in the Port and 2,200 square feet in the Haven. Also, Mr. Brown stated in an email to me that all residents were advised of this amendment, AZ-130016.
A letter was sent by Attorney Lipscomb on July 23rd advising residents that never address the public hearing that was held on August 1st. This was also well after the first hearing on July 2nd that was postponed. I hope that you commissioners, and I guess you have, will have another public hearing for this, because it is your responsibility to reject this amendment to a zoning ZA 2457. Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
Thank you, Ms.
You have to talk for a second. Ma'am, I have re-postponed that for that purpose of a public hearing. So right. Hopefully the residents will get with Mr. Lipscomb to set that date. And I'm going to get a copy of the date, and I plan on being there as well.
Our next speaker is Felicia, Brazile.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm Felicia Brazile, and I also live in WES. I'm here tonight to ask you to deny the zoning condition amendment for ZA 2457, filed by 149905 Hopewell. My reasons for wanting you to deny this application are simple: traffic safety, noise, overcrowding, etc. But I will focus on what I believe is the foremost reason this zoning condition amendment should be denied. That is the improper notice of public hearings and public participation. Hopewell's representative requested a postponement of the July 2nd public hearing to allow us to complete the public participation meeting as required by the UDC. No public participation meeting was ever held by Hopewell Group. In accordance with UDC section 8-9.4B1C, if the applicant postpones the public hearing, he is also required to pay for the cost of re-advertising the application for public hearing and agrees to post public notice signs on the property, as may be determined by the director to be necessary to ensure procedural due process. Hopewell also had an obligation and a duty to inform us of the postponed public hearing pursuant to the public notice sign affidavit executed on June 11th by Charles Castleberry, the same person that requested the postponement. The affidavit states that it is the applicant's responsibility to place and maintain the signs on the subject property. The term maintain means that the sign shall remain standing, be readable, and be updated regarding any changes in the date of public hearing. That sign still says July 2nd is the date of the public hearing. It has never been changed to reflect that the actual public hearing date is August 1st. Finally, Mr. Lipscomb sent a letter which was received by us on or about July 25th. The UDC requires that this letter contain the application number, applicant name, contact information, details regarding the date, time, and location of the required public participation meeting, and any additional proposed meetings. Mr. Lipscomb does not mention a public participation meeting and does not mention the August 1st public hearing date. We, the citizens of Forsyth County, depend on you as our commissioners to protect us from these kinds of deceptive and possibly unlawful acts. I would propose to you tonight that as a result of the applicant's failure to properly notice the public hearing and holding no public participation meetings as required by the UDC, his application for zoning condition amendment is deficient and should be denied. Lastly, commissioners, there are several of us here that are opposed to the zoning condition amendment passing as currently submitted.
Would all of my neighbors that are opposed please stand? Thank you.
Thank you very much for your time.
Our next speaker is Deborah Foote.
Commissioners, my name is Deborah Foote. I live in Bethlehem Downs. I have been both of you, and I've even made pictures of the property that is represented in zoning amendment request AZ130016. I object to this zoning amendment because it is not, in fact, an amendment. 17.5 acres of property ZA2457 is zoned for commercial zoning. The portion of this property, which was suitable for homes, approximately 74 acres zoned R3, has already been developed to the maximum by 40 homes in 2000. That is the current 324 sites currently known as Bethlehem Downs. If the section of 17.5 acres were suitable for houses constructed, Pulte Construction would have done it and utilized it in 2000. Because it was not suitable, the balance of the property, the 17.5 acres in question here, was zoned C4 commercial. This land does not pass home site zoning requirements in 2000, nor does it today. how we could possibly consider a request to amend a commercially zoned property to build a new residential unit. A rezone application, that's different. If in fact that's what it is, that the homes would be suitable for construction, then requiring the owner to legally request a new zoning status, to follow the code, to follow procedure, and not try to slide this by as an amendment, force them to present to you an engineered site plan which is sealed, which is stamped, and which is submitted by a qualified engineering firm. By presenting this as an amendment to rezone a commercial land package, the proposer is asking you to sanction fraud. Remember, the proposer is not seeking to add a community to FOB Downs, home division zoned R3, but he seeks to develop a new residential community on commercial zoned property. He's not seeking to join the covenants of ownership governing FOB Downs. He's not requesting to join our residential development. He wants to build a new one. That's new zoning, not an amendment. I speak this issue specifically to you, Commissioner Levent, because you're my representative on the board and you're a builder. Considering the impact of the surrounding neighborhood on Bethlehem Downs, the current zoning laws of Forsyth County would prevent a plan to develop this property as residential. I believe that 14905 Hopewell Group knows this, and that's why they seek to amend commercially zoned property rather than rezone for the same reason. It simply would not pass. It's your responsibility to protect me, protect this community, and to protect the taxpayers of Forsyth County from libel by rejecting passing this illegally contrived plan to avoid the rules and codes of Forsyth County. Please reject it. And one question, did you hold that postponement, Commissioner Levent? Is that going to be postponed with the opportunity for public input or simply for vote?
It will be for public input, discussion, proper signage, and proper advertisement.
Who knows, people?
Our next speaker is Lou Melancon.
Exactly what it says. And it says single family detached, fee simple, 378 units with a minimum heated floor area of 600 square feet and a minimum lot size of 3,000 square feet. That's what's on the website as of this morning. 378 units at a density of 4.5 units per acre. Further, there's an evaluation attachment, improvements and amenity statement. And it says on page two, paragraph six, rezoning the subject property to any classification other than the requested Res 6 classification at a density less than requested will impose a disproportionate hardship on the applicant and owners of the subject property without benefiting any surrounding property owners. There is no reasonable use of the subject property under any other zoning classification than that of the requested Res 6. On page 3, paragraph 2, the subject property is presently suitable for development under the Res 6 zoning classification as requested by the applicant. And it is not suitable for development under any other zoning classification or at a density less than that requested by the applicant. I stand before you to represent the communities of Arden Greens, Bennington, Brandon Hall, Vicki Lane, Cascading Creek Estates, Castleton, Grandview, Muirfield, Blackstock Mill, Woodland Park, and Waterstone Falls, Kensington, Dave Street Colleges, and Brandon Oaks, and the 2,000 families that are represented and living in these communities, with an average density in their developments, all combined at 1.7 units per acre. We ask for consistency of zoning We do believe in development, and we do believe in good development. There is no proven pent-up demand for a Res 6 development. As of today, on homes.com, there are 1,340 homes for sale in Forsyth County. 547 are for less than $250,000. So that means there's a lot of houses available for less than $250,000. But more importantly, it means that the demand is not for less than $250,000. It's for houses that are more than $250,000. When this was given to the Planning Commission, they said, and I quote, "It is vacant land with dense tree coverage, steep slopes, and wetland areas. Safe waters were also located on the site," and they said no. Since then, we've heard talk about Res 4, but the application has never been changed. The application is for Res 6. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
Thank you, sir.
Our next speaker is Gabrielle Pollmeier. Commissioners, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Gabrielle Pollmeier and I'm a resident of Forsyth County for 17 plus years. I live on Vicky Lane with my husband. We own and operate an internationally known breeding and show kennel. Our property borders directly on the proposed development, 88 Dave's Creek LLC zoning application 3623. And we are discussing this here tonight. My husband and I have noticed that there is no special provision of any kind of buffers and no provision for a specific kind of fencing when this proposed development borders onto our property. Furthermore, and this is particularly disturbing to us, the various streams which run directly to our property and which border our property on the right-hand side have not been taken into consideration at all, nor are there any plans or proposals to safeguard these streams. Are there any stipulations made to the owner builder of this development demanding that most of the trees which border the property and our property in particular will be left in place, cannot be cut down, so as to act not only as a natural buffer but also act as a noise buffer? If not, we have to insist that such stipulations be made, since, for example, the noise level from the quarry, in particular, though the noise level from the concrete plant will increase to an intolerable level, and this noise will then most likely travel unaltered as far as the swimming pool in Windermere subdivision, especially in winter months. We live on 6 acres, and if stipulations and requirements are not made to the owner-builder of the proposed development, our property will suffer a significant drop in value, which of course we very much object to. Not only do we request the density of the development not to be above Res 2.2, but we also request proper and appealing fencing, privacy fencing, to be put up, especially concerning those houses directly bordering our property, and we also request that those particular houses have either brick, stone, cedar shingles, or stucco in the back where they can be seen from our property. We do not want to look at cheap siding which peels and comes off as soon as it has been put up on the houses, like some other subdivision houses this builder has built in Forsyth County. Concerning the streams, both the one going through our property as well as the one bordering our property, are homes to various forms of wildlife, some of which are protected species, and we are concerned that if very specific stipulations are not made to the owner-builder of the proposed development, these little streams will disappear or at best be so polluted that they will no longer serve as habitat for the wildlife living there right now and state or federal protected. In summary, we are asking you, commissioners, to make sure that the proposed development fits within the zoning range of adjoining developments which have a density of 1.7, that this proposed development does not go above 2.2, that this development has generous buffers towards sites, especially all along the quarry sites. Any chance I can finish?
How much longer?
Well, 1 minute.
Any opposed? Okay, just use the whole time.
Yeah. That this development does not cut down any of the trees within these buffers and will also incorporate the trees in an additional noise view buffer all around the property lines, but especially bordering our property lines. We are also asking that all materials and looks of the proposed buildings are on a par with the houses being built, for example, in Seneca and other upmarket subdivision in and around the Greater Dave's Creek or Atlanta area.
We are asking that the builder and owner of the proposed development has to discuss and come to agreement with any property owners bordering on the new development regarding fencing. Lastly, we would like you, commissioners, to not set a precedent for high density housing in the Greater Vicky Lane and Dave's Creek area. Thank you for listening and giving me an additional minute.
Thank you.
Would you mind showing me where your house is on this map, ma'am?
Yeah, ma'am.
Would you mind showing me where your house is, your property back to this?
Sure. Chairman, just notify you we're at the 30-minute mark. Do we have two more speakers, Judge?
There are four additional speakers signed up, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, the
Todd. We can do that when we get to our zone.
Mr. Chairman, the rules anticipate that if we want to add some time, we can do that by motion and second to add a certain amount of time for the public comments.
How many do we have left?
There are four more speakers signed up.
Count with the out-of-county speaker.
Yes, sir.
How much time do y'all give us? 12 minutes? More?
As much as they want. We have some other places.
How about this 1 minute per person?
Let's give them two minutes. So make a motion, give them 10 extra minutes.
Sir,
I'm motion second. 10 extra minutes, please vote. Yes, it is. Number 10, Jim.
Our next speaker is Pat Mullaney.
Hello, my name is Pat Mullaney. I'm here representing Bluegrass Materials. It's the stone quarry right off of Ronald Reagan. It's all in reference to 88 Dave's Creek, zoning ZA3623. Bluegrass Materials purchased the Cumming Quarry from Lafarge in late March of this year. Bluegrass Materials Company and its predecessors such as Lafarge, Blue Circle, Georgia Marble, and Hall Aggregates have operated at this location since the late 1950s. The site is approximately 568 acres. Granite is drilled, blasted, crushed, and screened to make crushed stone of size and quality to meet customers' demand. Our products are used primarily on road building and construction. Along with our mining operation, four concrete plants and two asphalt plants that purchase our products but are owned by other companies operate at the Cumming Quarry. Bluegrass Material employs directly and indirectly through our on-site customers about 150 full-time employees and contributes a significant property and sales taxes to Forsyth County. We have worked hard at being responsible and representative community member. Our business strongly supports development and particularly in construction. However, Bluegrass Material has a duty to our employees, stockholders, and stakeholders, such as our existing neighbors and customers, to assess the impacts of a potential development, such as 88 Dave's Creek, and to determine the impacts to the long-term viability of our operations. Concerns that come to mind. 88 Dave Creek is surrounded on three sides of our property owned by Bluegrass Materials. This puts residential property immediately adjacent to heavy industrial and an active mine site that may not be suitable for neighbors in such close proximity. Noise, dust, and vibration are created. Engineered and permitted berms or other suitable mitigation screens must be built by the developer at the developer's cost and expense along the property boundary. A good reputation within the communities where we operate is very important to the sustainability of our company. Mitigation screens mentioned above will be necessary for our company to maintain its reputation. Quarries can be very dangerous. Bluegrass Materials would have the increased burden and liability for curious trespassers that live so close. Additional precautions along the proposed project will likely be necessary to prevent unauthorized access. Bluegrass Materials Company respectfully requests that the rezoning of this property be delayed until these issues are adequately addressed. We have yet to see the final site plan.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Karen Dowell.
Hi, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Okay,
I'm Carol, and I live at Arden's community. I've been a resident of Arden's community for almost 9 years, and we've been fortunate to have a beautiful forestation, which is very healthy for all of us. We have a special situation. We have a wonderful company that we were just talking about, a quarry, which creates a wonderful opportunity for jobs and growth and construction. However, with the deforestation of that area for 88, the entity known as 88 Cave Creek development, is creating a huge health hazard. This health hazard is dramatic. Silicone dioxide results in pulmonary tuberculosis. It also is terrible for pulmonary problems for people with COPD. It can even lead to death. The other problem with anything with concrete, we have carbon dioxide, which is released as a gas, and the other product is released as dust in the air. Now, we have never had a problem before because of the wonderful forestation that all the green of the trees absorbs it and makes oxygen. Great. Now, when that is taken away, what we have is a huge volume of dust in the air, of gases released. Some of the gases and some of the products are ferric acid, magnesium oxide, calcium oxide, sodium oxide, potassium oxide, but the worst one is the silicone. It is a carcinogenic listed across all the boards that are important. So we need never to have that forestation removed. It is critical, not just for Arden Green or Windermere, it's for everybody in Forest County. Thank you.
Please speak when you turn, please.
Okay, well, they're the constituents, as you are, and they need to know. And so this is really a quarry into what we need to do. We need anecdotal studies. We need government entities. We need the levels of anything that's already and what will be when the trees are taken away. Can you imagine the trees taken away? What will that do to this whole area? It destroys it and destroys our life. This is a great business. They should not be impacted. They are important. I hope you will consider that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Susan Michelikos. Our next speaker is Rebecca Reeves Carter.
My name is Rebecca Reeves Carter. I'm president of Edible Hills Corporation. I come from Lumpkin County, and I'm here to give you a jolt of happiness. I want to thank you very much for your courageous and thoughtful vote at your workshop meeting to abandon the Calhoun Creek Reservoir Project. It's something that has been on our mind, and we have been fighting for 2.5 long years. I want to tell you that I've had a wonderful and positive experience dealing with Carol Hay, Doug Durer, and Ken Girard from 2.5 years ago. And you have just continued that wonderful and impressive line of experiences. Last week, when you continued your tradition of using judicious power, of using your power judiciously and tempering it with compassion, not just for a voter, but for your neighbors in another county. Thank you for abandoning the Calhoun Creek Reservoir Project, and on behalf of the people of Lumpkin County, whose lives would have been destroyed by that sprawling reservoir, I sincerely express gratitude.
Thank you.
That was our final speaker, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. on item six, the adoption of the minutes. Is there a motion to adopt the minutes of the regular meetings of the years of August 1st, 2013?
So moved.
Second. Have a motion. Second.
Please vote.
Motion carries 5-0. Is there a motion to adopt the minutes of the work session, the executive session, August 6th, 2013?
Second.
Motion second to adopt. Please vote. That motion carries 5-0. Is there a motion to adopt the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second. That motion second to adopt the consent agenda. Please vote. That motion carries 5-0. Item 8, old business. Zoning request. 88 Days Creek, LLC ZA 3623. A1 to Red 6. Tom?
Can you just give a moment about the folks that are out?
Zoning application 3623, 88 Dates Creek, LLC. Located in Commission Districts 3 and 5. The request is to rezone 83.68 acres from A1 to Res 6 for 378 attached residential homes with a density of 4.52 units per acre. This property is located on the north side of Dave Street Drive across from Dave Street Lane. The Planning Commission recommends approval of this rezoning from A1 to Res 4 at 2.95 units per acre with a maximum of 247 units. The proposed conditions are shown on your screen. And the public hearing was conducted on June 25th, 2013.
Thank you, Tom. It's in District 3 and 5, I guess, as it says, Part 3, Part 5. Before we start, I know, is there any comments from the board or questions? Commissioners?
Just because of all the information that gets put on us, has been put on us throughout this whole the process of this project, and all the emails we get back and forth and some conflicting each other from one week to the next, I really dug deep into this. Had meetings, I even reached out and some folks gave me some conditions in which they'd like to see added to this, which I believe we put together for them all in a very small amount. And when you do read these off and you see these, if you're missing any, some of them are part of the UDC already and didn't need to be duplicated on here. I know it's not perfect. I know it's not exactly what you wanted, but you're probably in the 95% range or 90% range. Before we do any motions or any suggestions of motions, I would like to touch on a couple of things. As I read the information about the concrete dust and mineral waste toxicities that were created tossing their mine without the density of the trees, I suggest that the rock quarry read some of the zoning conditions at which their rock quarry was zoned under. One was 2724. And it holds you to very strict rules along with the state regulating you to keep your toxicities and your dust on your own property, or they'll shut you down. It doesn't become another person's problem. Your stuff gets on their property, they could actually find you as the trespasser with your toxicities and such. To tell a man that he has to put up a barrier to stop what you're creating, I couldn't imagine any court land backing that up. You gotta read your zoning conditions and read your state rules and regs which govern you. If I denied this based on those premises alone, I'm sure we'd be in court. I don't know how to rule, but I can't imagine that they would hold them liable for what your toxicities were leaving your property onto theirs, which in the law reads or could be construed as trespassing their property and damaging their property. I also read this and I'm looking for somebody's done tests. Has anybody done the airborne tests? Where were they located on the property when they did the test? Did they do soil tests? Or is this pure speculation based on what this dust can cause? And that's the whole, you know, I haven't seen that full body test from anybody, but that also should be brought up with this state regulating body. Because if it is happening and the crop quarry is doing this, then they need to do something to stop it. That would be my opinion on it anyways. If I was sitting on my property and I was doing all kinds of things and absolutely disrupting my neighbor, they'd call the police. Noise or not, or whatever it is. If I'm shooting bottle rockets or doing anything that gets a lot of smoke on their property, all those things, there's laws to protect them from me doing that to them. Just saying. I think it's kind of got twisted around it a little bit. Who's responsible for whose mess? If there is a mess, I don't think there is one. I never heard this until the zoning came up. I don't see any full studies that actually show there is. I only see this that says if you remove the forest, it could happen. Nobody's gotten up at a certain level to capture any airborne dust and test it to tell me what the danger might or might not be. They haven't called the state regulatory body to see either. It just seems like a stab in the wind to scare everybody. I will request that this letter that was sent to us be sent to the state and also sent to Bluegrass for further explanation. If there is a problem, it needs to be handled. But if it's just a farce to scare us away from doing a zoning, that's not right. I don't know what it is. That being said, I hope I covered all the zoning conditions which were asked for. The fence, ma'am, would you mind showing me where your property is on this thing for a fence? If you'd really like to see them.
Can I look at a bigger one?
Yeah, please. Just be careful this morning. Here's your property line, right?
This is the street of the property lines, right? This is not the property line. This is supposed to be the property line. The property line is totally split through that street.
Actually, I can't get a fence there, but they can get a fence. So you're a couple hundred feet over here. How about this right over here? They'll get you in the water.
Oh, they have to put the fence here.
Commissioner Levent, Commissioner.
Yeah. Well, further, I guess, back to my statements and some of the research we did and some of the things we've got done based on my last motion, the last meeting that brought us here today. What is being displayed up is now the plan from the Res 4, which everybody was looking for. It has been produced. There it is. It's got the state water showing in it. I'm going to show you the paperwork about submitting it, everything that I was looking for, I asked for, we got it. It also has a seal on it. If you can see the seal in the bottom right corner. It's round. May I see the first page, please? It Let me further note that those to seal at this stage of the game and a final site plan is truly not, is not required. And we've been through this with council and the director of departments. We've asked these folks to do something over and above. It's in our UDC. It says, et cetera. And their terminology of that was because the reason why it's not required at this stage in a sketch plan is simply that there's so many condition changes between this point and what they would bring us to this point that always those plans have to be changed, and not to put a financial burden on whether it's a developer or just a small mom and pop trying to come forward and get something, little something done in their land, doesn't put a huge financial burden on them to do anything more than a sketch plan at first until all the conditions are resolved. Then they get the final plan done for engineering and such to approve. I want to be clear that they did not have to have a seal on there at this point in the game, or a perfect plan at this point in the game. Number one, you're going to see something from our Department of Engineering from April 29, 2013. They gave them the thumbs up on the state waters in which they did their sketch plan. Number two, please. This was requested by the public, and I put in my motion for the public. If you'll slide up a little bit, you can see the certification of the company that did it. This is their water, a certified company, which they'll ask for, and which they redid their plan with, which matches the county paperwork. We have another one. And so that covers my motion that y'all asked me to do for reset purposes. It covers it all. Thank you, Jim. Is there anything else anybody else had that they, I may have missed through all of this, going through this? I think we've covered all of it. There's so many emails, so forgive me if I forgot anything that y'all asked for. They bounce back and forth. Some people say one thing, that a week later getting them saying the opposite thing. It got really confusing there for a while. I hope I covered everything. I hope that this piece of paper, they have all the conditions, covers everything you're looking for. If it's missing three or four, once again, they're in the UDC law already, and we don't redundantly replace them here. If you don't mind, yeah, I would like to put that up one more time, please. This has never been done to this extent of me going through things, so if it seems odd, it is a little bit. And I'm trying to satisfy everybody. Zoom in just a little bit. And bring it up a little bit. There you go. All right, so you can see the property in the bottom center part of the page, rock quarry just above it. You've got a res 4 just barely on the other side of rock quarry. Just above that, and it's not focusing perfect, but you have a res 6. We have folks here that are also from Windermere, as much as from anywhere else, worried about the density. Inside Windermere is a putt. True enough, it is an absolute putt. But inside that putt are multiple res 4s with a higher density than the 2.95 that was recommended by the Planning Commission. It also has a set of apartments as a res 6. I, for one, like to look at everything fair and equally across the board. If you're going to come from a neighborhood and say everything around is 1.7, it's only a fair you count your neighborhood too, concerning you. If you're there, it must be a wide enough range to include your neighborhood too in that calculations. Thank you, Jim. I may have the proposed zoning conditions back up, please. Just so you may be able to read them one more time, just scroll slowly for everybody.
Ms. Lloyd.
What conditions to get to 22? Actually, I'm sorry, up to 26.
Scroll back to 22. Accepting all conditions that were shown as they were shown, with additionally adding a fence, which is now just put on the screen between the two arrows. And please apologize if I put your name wrong. Under the, I can't read the door, thank you. Gabrielle.
No, it's Doris and Mark.
Fine, Silva.
Thank you. On the parcel. 154020. We had a fence between the two arrows, 6-foot fence, privacy fence.
What size?
6-foot.
6-foot. Privacy.
And that's my motion.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Got a motion. Second. Any discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 3-2 for approval.
Mr. Chairman, there were two documents in addition to the site plan, which I believe the Commissioner Levent got it as mentioned. There was a state water report, and then there was a color zoning map. You just direct that those be placed in the zoning file for the evening. That would be an action, Mr. Grosh.
So then, please do it, Councilman. Item 2 has been postponed and set for the 5th. Item 9, new business. Item 1A, Midway Community Church, CP130002.
CP130002, Midway Community Church, located in Commission District Number 3, requests for a conditional use permit for the purpose of an accessory building for an existing worship facility, 6,324 square feet on 11.51 acres of property, currently zoned A1. The property is located at 3365 Francis Road, Alpharetta, Georgia, 30004. The Planning Commission recommends approval of the issuance of this conditional use permit. The public hearing was held on July
23rd, 2013. Thank you, Mr. Brown. District 3, is there a motion to District 3 for 1A? Midway Community Church. Sir? No, we don't have a public hearing. Decision only, sir.
Move that we approve the COP 130002 issuance of the conditional use permit as listed.
Have a motion and a second for approval of Midway Community Church. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. 1B, Jennifer A. Blackburn, CP130004. Issue a conditional use permit for the purpose to construct a 160-foot monopole telecommunication facility. Mr. Brown?
CP130004, Jennifer A. Blackburn, located in Commission District Number 1. The request is for a conditional use permit for the purpose of a 160-foot monopole telecommunications facility in a leased area of 3.0 acres currently zoned M1. The property is located at 2520 Jake Drive, Cumming, Georgia, 30028. The Planning Commission recommends approval of the issuance of this conditional use permit with conditions. Proposed conditions are shown on your screen. And the public hearing was held on July 23, 2013.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Commissioner District 1, I make a motion that we approve Jennifer A. Blackburn, CP130004, for the issuance of conditional use permit for the purpose of to construct a 160-foot monopole telecommunication facility on property currently zoned M1 with the conditions as shown on our screen by staff.
Sir.
Have a motion and a second for approval. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item C, Rex Stables. Let you handle that,
CA3604, Rex Stables, located in Commission District Number 4. The request is to rezone 16.308 acres from A1 Residue to A1 with a conditional use permit for a commercial for scale of 2,350 square feet of commercial area to two parking spaces. A variance is requested to eliminate the 20-foot side and rear buffer per UDC Chapter 15-1.3, Table 5, 15.2. The property is located on the west side of Concord Road, approximately 650 feet northeast of the intersection of Purple Place, and on the east side of Riley Road, approximately 700 feet north of the intersection of Purple Place. The Planning Commission recommends approval of this rezoning from A1 and Res 2 to A1 with a conditional use permit with conditions. Those conditions are shown on your screen. The public hearing was held on June 25th, 2013.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. As we stroll through the conditions, this is located in Commission District 4, Commissioner Mills.
I'd like to make a motion that we approve ZA3604 A1 Res 2 to A1 with a conditional use permit for a commercial horse stable and a variance to the side and rear buffer requirements with conditions as stated on screen.
Second discussion. I have a motion and second for discussion.
I believe that the planning board the health department makes notice that a barn structure is supposed to be at least 300 feet from a neighboring residential structure. And I've come to understand from Tom Brown that that's been a law or ordinance since 65. And I'm not 100% sure, but I think that the neighboring house was built first, means that the barn at this point would be, unless somebody has a permit or some other documentation, in my mind would be against health code. And that, unless somebody says something to the contrary, I don't think it's appropriate to approve this.
I'd ask Mr. Brown a question. I don't think we had any zoning in 1965 here.
Well, we had a comment that came from the health department, and when our staff asked them for more information about this 300-foot requirement, they identified they felt that it was in place since the 60s. You're correct. Our zoning ordinance wasn't adopted until the 70s.
Any other questions from the board? We have a motion. Second to approve item C with conditions as shown. Please vote. Motion carries 3-2. Item D, E. Howard Carson Jr., ZA3630. At this time, I would like to accuse myself of any vote or discussion on this matter. I'll return the meeting over to Vice Chairman Commissioner Bob at this time.
Zoning application 3630E Howard Carson Jr. located in Commission District Number 5. The request is to rezone 47.02 acres from A1 to S4 for 80 residential lots with a density of 1.7 units per acre. A variance is requested to allow separation between lots to be 15 feet as measured between foundations. The property is located on the southeast side of Tremble Road at the intersection of Dade Street Drive and Castles. Planning Commission recommends approval of this rezoning from A1 to Res 3 with variance and conditions. Those variance and conditions are shown on the screen. Public hearing was held on July 23rd, 2013.
Excuse me. What did you say the density was for this development?
1.7 units per acre.
1.7.
I thought it said 2.5. review the file and make sure my minutes are correct. My notes.
I just don't want us to have a glitch and have to come back to this.
Be a glitch in the regular.
Is that 2.5 is in error?
I have the site plan also showing 1.70, 80 units on 47 acres.
2.7?
Request for rest 4, and the planning commission recommended rest 3.
If I remember correctly, but when I looked at all this, that's back when it was res 4, it was at a 2.93. When it reduced down to the res 3, it automatically, and they bumped it down to 2.5, which is the res 3 now.
That might be the case. That wasn't submitted through our department. So 2.93 is part of the original site plan for res 4.
2.5 is condition number 1.
Yeah,
that's condition number 1. I see that.
Yeah.
So if we do approve this, Counselor, I'm okay just going with the conditions are showing, and that will do
the
that?
The condition is shown clarifies it, yes, as far as it is.
I move that we approve ZA-3631 as displayed on the screen.
Second. Counselor, just for purpose of clarification, I know this is what you meant, that as the conditions are displayed on
that's
the screen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Have a motion to second. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item F, Lennar, Georgia Incorporated, ZA-3633, A1 to rest forward of the variance to reduce the required district structures. Variance to reduce the front yard setback on lots 27, 28, 63, 64. And the variance reduced exterior yard setback to allow the exterior yard setback of 25 feet on lots 96 and 115. Mr. Brown.
Zoning application 3633 Lennar, Georgia, Inc., Commission District Number 3. The request is to rezone 71.42 acres from A1 to Res 4 for 150 residential lots with a density of 2.1 units per acre. Variances are requested to reduce the required distance between structures to 11 feet, to reduce the front yard setback by 5 feet, to allow front yard setback to 15 feet on lots 27, 28, 63, and 64, and to reduce the exterior yard setback by 25 feet to allow an exterior yard setback of 25 feet on lots 96 and 115. The property is located on the west side of Molnax Road, approximately 2,500 feet southeast of the intersection of the Atlanta Highway. Planning Commission recommends approval of this rezoning from A1 to Res 4 with variances and conditions. The proposed variances and conditions are shown on your screen, and the public hearing was held on July 23rd, 2013.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Commissioner Levin, your district again, busy one tonight.
Yes, sir. I will say this, when you see variances up front, when you're doing your zoning, I sure would like to see that instead of just getting something passed and coming back later and doing it again. So, and I know that these few variances are here based on the lake, and I truly understand why you have to do that to get out of the floodplain. I want you to go back to the top, please. I move that we approve ZA-3633 with the conditions shown and the additional variances.
Second part. The council does have to say additional variances or the variances as shown?
I'll say the variances as shown.
Variances as shown, variances as requested, so long as the record is clear. I think it's clear.
Variances requested, variances as shown.
And a motion. Second.
I believe there was some additional.
Yeah, there was one.
Okay.
I would request that the second would be with your own. I don't know whether you got second. If you took me as the second, I would withdraw.
Or I
withdraw.
I withdraw your motion.
I apologize. There was one more condition I had to, which I'm going to have them put up here in a moment. These are conditions that had to be worked out between the engineering department and the developer.
Okay.
takes liability off the county.
What?
Takes liability off the county.
That's a good addition.
All right, once again, I make a motion to approve ZA 3633 as displayed along with the variances as displayed and shown and his additional conditions, which I just placed on the screen.
Second.
We have a motion and a second for approval. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item 2, request by staff for board directive if the board desires to draft a policy regarding a financing option for commercial sewer customers. Mr. Perkins.
Mr. Chairman, we discussed this at the work session recently, and basically we have a sewer customer who has a need to purchase additional sewer capacity in an existing facility that when they came in for a permit modification or expansion, it triggers an automatic review of the sewer capacity usage, and he has a need to purchase. Final numbers have not been determined, but approximately $19,000 or $20,000 worth of sewer capacity, and is asking if there's any way that that can be financed or payments can be made by the board. I know of a couple of other companies that similar things are occurring. One of those has also expressed a desire to be able to make payments on this. We don't have a policy guiding us on such. As you might recall, recently we did a similar thing for a nonprofit where we allowed them to make payments over time. So I believe this tonight, the policy, Ken's office has started drafting a policy, but the request was just guidance of whether or not the board wanted us to develop a policy to address this type of request. It's not something, I would say, for the Water and Sewer Department, but I do know that back in 2008-2009, we were attempting to get companies to purchase capacity when they were exceeding. We had 129 at that time that we knew were going to need to buy more capacity, and we've been requested to start searching for those companies again. And so I think tonight it was giving guidance for us whether or not to move forward in developing a policy like this, if the board wanted us to do this or leave it up to them to go back to a lending institution, I suppose.
Mr. Chairman, just to supplement what Mr. Perkins said, this was discussed at the last work session. I believe the board was not unanimous on it, and that is why it does come out on an open agenda and not the consent agenda.
So tonight we just need guidance to you to draw the policy of the prices as well?
That's correct. The board has already voted on it, but because it was not unanimous, our rules say it comes back here for you all to vote again in the open session and to discuss if you need to.
Any questions about this, Commissioners? I believe you kind of set some parameters last time, Counselor?
You did. In my office is already working with Mr. Perkins' office, and we're going to obviously work with Mr. Gruen's office as well.
Brings it back to a work session?
Or yes, sir. It's going to come back to you.
Do we hear a motion from the board? I'll make a motion to direct the counselor to proceed with the policy to finance some type of money for the commercial water customers.
Sir.
Any other questions?
Bring it back to work session.
Bring it back to work session. Any other questions? Please vote. Motion carries 4-1. Item 3, Counselor, you put on the agenda.
Mr. Chairman, yes, sir. You should have in front of you at your stations a affidavit of the Board of Commissioners with respect to the local Democratic Party's nomination to our Board of Elections and Registrations. Pursuant to the local law that establishes the Board of Registrations and Elections, they are one of the entities that gets a pick on our Board of Registrations and Elections. Two things I need from you this evening. The first thing is, their recommendation or their nomination is a Mr. Matt Blender. His term is set to expire fairly shortly. He has been the individual that has been serving for a while and obviously has been doing a very capable job in that role. So the first thing I would need the board to do is to ratify or approve Mr. Blender's appointment to the Board of Elections and Registrations. The local Democratic Party's executive committee did nominate him at a regular meeting. There is a letter in that attachment that identifies that. So the first thing I need is a motion to accept Mr. Blinder's appointment to the Board of Registration and Elections.
So move. Have a motion second to accept Mr. Blinder's nomination. Please vote. Motion carries five zero.
Mr. Chairman, the next thing I need is you to approve the, just to approve the affidavit. You will sign that, and then we will run that over to the clerk of the Superior Court, where it must remain on file for 30 days.
So move.
Second. Have a motion second to approve the affidavit. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Counselors, at the meeting for the executive session to discuss litigation plan acquisition and our personnel.
Mr. Chairman, I regret to inform you that there is. I do need a very quick executive session to go over a time-sensitive litigation item. I do not anticipate coming back to the open session and taking action, but we will reconvene in the open session after the executive session is completed.
How quick is really quick?
My definition is very quick, Mr. Dan.
Is there a motion to recess the Board of Commissioners meeting at 6:37? For the purpose to reconvene in the executive session for the purpose of litigation, land acquisition, and our personnel. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. We will go right into the executive session, Council. No break.
No break.
No break.
No break.
It takes 5 minutes.
Ms. Tisdale, can you superimpose our phone numbers in front of us?
Yeah.
If you'll provide it.
I have more of those back there.
Jim was eyeing some of those watermelons, but I got
them. I haven't been to the store lately.
You're earning your money, aren't you?
Yeah, I think we do that quite well.
Y'all have two.